Hello and welcome to video 6.3. In the previous video we've introduced the Kalman filter and the extended Kalman filter, and I know that things have been pretty theoretical there, and this is why we have now in this video a whole bunch of nice visualizations and a pretty nice example on how this EKF looks like in practice. So imagine that we have a robot that is moving in 2D. And then, as you know, we can describe its state with three parameters because it has X position, Y position, and an orientation or heading, psi. This robot can move around. We assume it's a quadrotor, so it can move in all directions arbitrarily. So it can move forward using it can move forward with a speed of x dot, it can move sidewards using a speed of y dot, and it can rotate around its axis using a speed of psi dot. And furthermore, we assume that the robot can make occasionally or occasionally makes observations. Again, it sees a visual marker with its camera, and it can determine its pose relative to the robot. So it sees a marker at a particular location x and y, and in a particular orientation psi. And now it's important to note that we represent the state in global coordinates. So this x and y and psi are with respect to a global coordinate frame that is located somewhere in the world. But our odometry and the observations of the visual marker are given in the local frame of the robot, which means, which is typically the case with a robot, depends of your sensors, but typically all sensor measurements are made in the intrinsic frame of the robot. So when the robot goes forward, it doesn't care about where the origin of the world it is, it just goes forward within its own coordinate frame, and the same applies typically to observations of its sensors. Because it has a camera, and in its camera image it sees somewhere a marker, so it's relative to its camera. This is not always the case, I should say. For example, if you look at GPS, then you always get global coordinates. But for most sensors like ultrasound or cameras, actually you make local observations. Good. And we've discussed this in depth already in week 2. So if you feel confused in this example by the coordinate transforms and the representations, then please go back to this video to get more details. And there are also some very nice exercises that you can do to refresh your knowledge of coordinate transforms. Good. So in any case, this is our representation of the state, and now the next question is, how do we actually represent, we need to specify two things, namely our motion function and our sensor function. You've done that before, or you've seen this before. The motion function depends on our current or previous state and our control that we give. And now we need to transform the speeds in the global frame. And so we can say that our new x position depends on the previous x position times this odometry speed rotated by our current heading angle times the time interval between which we get these odometry updates. And the same holds, of course, for the y-axis, and for our heading we have a much simpler expression because we can just add up our previous heading plus the rotation speed times our time interval. And we now need to apply to be able to, so this is clearly nonlinear because we have sine and cosine in the formula in our motion function. And to be able to run the EKF, we need now to linearize this motion function. And as we've seen in the previous video, for that we need to compute the derivative of the motion function, which means that we derive this function with respect to our current state, which gives us then a matrix. And this means that we end up with a 3x3 matrix in this case, where the columns correspond to the derivatives with respect to x, y, and psi. And the rows correspond to the rows that we had before, giving our successor state in x, y, and psi again. I think we also have such an exercise prepared for you, where you have to specify the motion function and derive something like this yourself. Good. For the sensor model, we also need to construct this sensor function or observation function. But this is a bit more complicated because we have to convert between these different coordinate systems. And this is as follows. Imagine that we know where the marker is located in global coordinates. You know, we know that somebody has attached a marker at 2 meters distance from the origin, and this marker is oriented into a certain direction. We need to know that to be able to compute the position of the robot if it sees this marker somewhere. So this is given a priori. The marker location in global world coordinates is given a priori. And then the robot makes local observations of this marker and uses this knowledge of where the marker is in the global coordinate frame to update its position estimate. Now for being able to use this in the Kármán filter, we need to define this observation function, which, given the state of our robot X, determines the sensor observation set. And because our sensor makes observations in its local frame, we need to compute the pose of the marker relative to the robot. And this can be done as follows. I mean, there are different ways of computing this, but this is, I thought, maybe the most intuitive one. So first, we can construct the transformation matrix that corresponds to our global robot pose. You've seen that before in week two. Given our x, y, and psi of the current state, we can construct this 3x3 transformation matrix. Remember, the upper left part is the rotation matrix, 2x2 in this case, and the upper right vector is x and y is our translation vector. And now we can use that to transform coordinates from the local system to the global system. But in our case, we are actually given global coordinates from which we need to infer the local coordinates. And this can be done by inverting x. But as you remember from week two, there is a very efficient way. We can just transpose the rotation matrix and replace the translation part with minus rotation matrix transposed times t. If we fill in the values, or if we fill in the formulas, then we end up with the following observation function. So the first two components are just this the local translation vector of our where we expect the marker to be seen by the robot, given its global coordinates. And for the orientation, we can just compute the difference between the global marker orientation minus our current heading of the robot. And this gives us then the local heading of the marker. And again, for the extended Kármán filter, we need to derive this observation function because it's again non-linear, similar to the motion model. And so we need to derive this with respect to all components of our state. So we derive x with respect to x, y, and psi. And then again, we obtain such a 3x3 matrix, which is again, which is called a Jacobian. And this is what we can then plug into our EKF. So just to pinpoint again the interesting parts, we have constructed the motion model G, which we can directly fill in here. We've derived G with respect to the state, which gave us this this matrix capital G that we plug in here. We have derived our sensor model, which we plug in then in this equation, and we have derived the sensor model, which gives us capital H that we need to compute the Kármán gain. So now we come finally to a few demo runs of our extended Kalman filter that we have constructed on the previous slides using the sensor model and the motion model as explained. We visualize now the state of the robot using using this black circle and with the black line. This visualization shows our mean estimate of the pose of the robot. So it shows the position in X and Y, and it shows our mean estimate of its orientation. And this robot now goes around, given us a sequence of observations for the moment, sequence of commands. We assume at the moment that we don't have any observations, so we just run the prediction step or the motion update of the Kalman filter until the end. And then the interesting thing is that we can also visualize the uncertainty or this covariance within the Kalman filter. So in this simulation, we assume that the robot is absolutely certain that it starts at the origin of the world, but the further it goes, the less certain it gets on his position. So this blue circle here, or the blue ellipse, now denotes its uncertainty. For example, depending on which ISO line you draw, this could be the 95% ISO line, which means that everything that's within the circle or that the probability mass within the circle has 95% of the total mass. And now after the first 10 steps, for example, we give a rotation command to the robot, so it will turn by 90 degrees, move around, and then move on. And as you can see, the uncertainty here of the robot state grows infinitely in principle. With every step, the robot gets a little bit less certain about where it is. But other than that, because we don't get any updates, our zero mean noise assumption says that we follow exactly the controls that we have given to the robot. Now for this example, now we just assume that there is a large process noise in for x and y in the odometry. If we now additionally assume that we also have noise in our heading, then the following happens. I let this run for a few steps. So the difference now is that the noise or the uncertainty in y direction increases dramatically. I should say here that we still have the same noise in x and y direction, but this new uncertainty now comes from the fact that the robot is additionally uncertain about its current heading, so it doesn't really know whether it still is looking perfectly to the right, or whether it has already turned to the left or to the right, and then, of course, if it would go forward, this would lead to a different position along the y-axis, and this is why this ellipse now grows much more in y direction than it does in x direction. And now here in this step, the robot turns in y direction, turns by 90 degrees, it moves on, and now it seems that this covariance actually rotates. This is actually not the case, so what happens here is that we have a very large uncertainty in y direction plus uncertainty in our heading direction, and so the more the robot moves now, the less certain it gets again in x direction, in left-right direction, you know, along its motion. And so we actually have an overlay of both the uncertainty in y direction that we had before, plus new uncertainty along the x direction now, and the combination of these two then give this new ellipsoid. And you can see that in combination now with the heading uncertainty, this ellipse really grows massively, so the robot is absolutely uncertain after it does the round where it is located. So now we will add some observations. For that, we assume that the robot can observe a marker in the world, but this marker can only be seen by the robot if it is close enough. So at this distance, it cannot see it cannot see the marker, and so the uncertainty grows as before. So it starts at the origin, moves to the right, and its uncertainty grows. And now when it comes close to the marker, it can actually detect it for a while. And what we can see now is that the uncertainty shrinks again, because as long as it sees the marker, it is perfectly certain, or it is more certain about its position than it was before. And then when it loses the visual contact to the marker, the uncertainty grows again as before. To see this again, so the uncertainty grows. When it detects the marker, the uncertainty shrinks, and then it loses again the contact to the marker, and the uncertainty grows again. So far we've assumed now that the robot has a good initial guess of its starting position, and now let's assume that we don't have a good guess. So the robot is actually again still moving from the origin indicated by these red crosses here, but our Kalman filter, because it has been initialized with an incorrect initial guess, is actually moving at a different location. So now the robot moves and has a growing covariance as before, and then as soon as it detects the marker, it can actually compute correct its position using the marker observation. And then you can see that it gets on track quite quickly, and if it now moves around, then it remains on track because it had this observation. So you can see how this marker pulls the state estimate to the right location. Good. And now we additionally assume that our yaw estimate is wrong. So and that we have some noise. We assume that we have some noise on our yaw estimate. So we get again this ellipsoid as before. But as you can see, we're relatively far away from the true position indicated by the red cross. But now again, as soon as we detect the marker, the Kalman filter pulls us to the right location, and it decreases correctly the covariance of the EKF. And then again, as soon as we lose visual contact to the marker, the covariance grows again with the behavior that we've seen before. Good. So I've indicated this already before. So if we have a bad initial guess, then it's generally a good idea. So typically you don't know really where you are in the beginning, to set the initial sigma to a large value. Because this means then that your state estimate is extremely uncertain, and this means that as soon as you get the first sensor observation, that you will immediately trust it, because then your sensor is more accurate than your current estimate of the state. So for example, here we have we start with a relatively large ellipsoid, and as you can see, the red crosses lies within this ellipsoid, which is typically what you want. The real state should be at a high probability within your covariance ellipsoid, and then as soon as we see the marker, it converges on the right location. And if you would compare this plot now with the plot that we had before, then you could see that it converges much faster to the marker, just because the marker gets more weight, because essentially we're intersecting the uncertainty, the observation of the marker, which is a Gaussian, with the with our state estimate, which is a Gaussian, and then we trust, of course, more to the Gaussian with the smaller covariance. So you can the main difference to the previous plot is that it converges faster, because now our uncertainty of the state is so large that we will trust the marker observation immediately. Good. And now one last example. Again, we have a wrong initialization. The marker is now located in the middle, and so whenever the robot comes close enough, it sees this marker and can reduce its uncertainty. Good. So to summarize the video of today, we've given a nice visualization, or a 2D example, of the extended Kalman filter. We've shown all the steps in the derivation of the motion model, and the construction and the derivation of the sensor model. And we've discussed, shown and discussed several example runs of the Kalman filter.